Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please remain standing for a moment of silence for the sake of handicapped departed and the military personnel of this community. Thank you.
There you go.
Bruce Valducci. Bill Cozy. Anderson.
Here.
Neil Lyons. George Washington.
Here.
Captain Lizio.
Here.
Tom Dermott.
Here.
Joe Sykes.
Here.
Lori Vaughn. Here.
Here.
There.
Here.
Call our visitors up. First visitor, Mary Weiss.
She helps a lot.
Thank you very much. I'm going to represent the Historic Society in about 1 second. The last few days, about last few weeks, I've been coming home via Route 50, which means I'm coming at lunchtime at 12:45. I'm coming home in the evening at 5 p.m. Yes, I still work for a living. What I noticed spectacularly, Chartier Street is empty. They keep emptying it. I sat for True Lights tonight while they emptied that. They emptied Washington Avenue. They kept that traffic coming past the new shopping center. So you should be happy about that. But if they had another way to get some of those people up off that hillside, they could get onto another highway and get home a lot faster than going through Birchville. That's my own personal opinion, and I look for it every night. It was good to see you today, too. Thank you. I was exiting work, and there he was, let me get out of the parking lot. The Historic Society is very active, as you well know. We have 9 major programs a year, and they are excellent. One on the steel industry, 1865 to 1905, last month was just fantastic. And you people missed it. This month, at the end of the month, we were having Jack Puglisi back again. Now Jack, I used to see him out at Borders. He could give you a full history of Benjamin Franklin or Winston Churchill or Abraham Lincoln or whomever, never look at a note. Somehow his mind photographs it. And this time it has something to do with art and history, and I don't know what it is. They say it's excellent. That's the last Tuesday night of this month, beginning at 7:30 at the Fire Hall. Again, thanks to the firemen because they let us use that facility, and we'll work for them anytime. Thank you for all that, and also, please, put on your calendars now, a Saturday afternoon in April, January 16th, between 1 and 4.
April.
I'm sorry, April. I do that all the time.
I know you do.
April, thank you. We are having an open house. One of my chairmen is here tonight, Karen Falcone. We have tremendous volunteers who are going to provide us some tours of what the place looks like and feed us some birthday cake. We have been in that facility, that 1871 building, for 5 years now. We've owned it for 5 years. That's thanks to Bob Banks, who had his roots here in Birchville and helped us get that. We also are going to honor all our volunteers. We have a huge amount of them. We could use a lot more to be open Mondays and Saturdays. At the moment, we're there Tuesdays to the Fridays. We're going to honor past and present volunteers. And then also, we're going to dedicate a bench dedicated to Lena Carosa, who is on our board of directors. And she was sharper at finance than 3 of you put together. So we really miss her. And sorry about that. That was good. She didn't have adding machines and computers. reminds me of a job I did have years ago at a church. A man I worked with would add faster than the people on the adding machines. But thank you very much for listening. Want to see you in the program. Want to see you definitely at our open house.
Mary, what time do you open?
1 to 4. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary. Liz Calabro.
Hi, guys.
Hello, Liz.
So I have another idea. The intersection of Bank Street, Chartiers, Lesnit, Mayview Road. The people coming from St. Clair like to charge through that intersection. I was thinking one thing that would help if they could be persuaded in St. Clair to put a sign on their side saying, dangerous intersection, slow down. Something like that, to make them aware that they do need to slow down for this intersection. Because they're charging through making sure nobody makes a turn.
That's still a state, maybe Rose still a state road. So if we call.
So it might help.
Stay the same. And
diffuse tempers.
We could request that from the state.
I think we'll help that intersection. And then the building that was proposed across from the post office. Is there going to be a hearing on that, or had it happened, or?
No application for the public.
Oh, yeah, thanks.
We'll let you know when it does.
Absolutely.
It's not a four-way intersection. Mike?
President?
How you doing, Mike?
Here's some pictures.
Want to share them?
Yeah, sure.
You're not us, that's illegal.
That's illegal.
Oh, yeah. You get the scrap yard.
Get scrap like that.
Yeah. First thing they do, they call the authorities. But I'm finding more in my yard and my sister-in-law's yard than anything. That's the problem. We feel that there's several issues that we need to be addressed by the council. The first one is the debris left along the railroad tracks after the recent update to the railroad lines. If you didn't know that they put new tracks in, they increased the speed of the trains. It wasn't bad when the Marcellus Shell was full blown because the trains would go, you know, come through the borough pretty slow. Well, now with the new rail lines, they're going at least 40 miles an hour. And that's something else that has to be addressed. But the problem is right now, the debris left along the railroad tracks, I was just wondering, hopefully, when they're going to start picking all that debris up. The second problem is stagnant water along the rail lines that collects. Behind Ramsey, there's a large pool of water, and behind, on the station side street, there's a large pool of water. As we know, you have the West Nile virus, which I called the Allegheny Health Department last year, and they set traps up, and they were telling me that the type of mosquito that carries the West Nile virus does not breed in that area of the borough. It breeds more behind the fire station than any place else. That's good. That's what they were talking about. No, I think Gloria thought. That's what he said. That's what he said. There's different types of mosquitoes.
They're far mosquitoes. Our state.
Very much. Yeah. I think mosquitoes are like birds. They'll go anywhere.
Yeah.
And now we have the Zika virus coming. And it hasn't hit, I believe it hasn't hit the states yet. The mosquito hasn't. The virus has. And in the future,
future, that's another problem that we're going to have. And I think we should be proactive and maybe trying to get the railroad to try to alleviate this problem. It is behind my property, so I ain't complaining about it. It's been behind my wife and my sister-in-law where they grew up for years. And that's something that hasn't been remedied in a long time. And, you know, they're making money. Mm-hmm. They get tax money from, you know, I mean, we pay for those tracks that were put in, mm-hmm. if you didn't know that. We pay federal taxes. There's a lot of money that goes to railroads. So, and there's at least 50 homes in that area. So, there's a lot of mosquitoes. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of kids. That's the third problem. Group of teenagers. Last summer, we put up with a lot of crap down there. Bruce drove down one night. I was walking the dog at midnight. Bruce happened to come by. There weren't any kids around. But I don't want to put up with what I had to put up with last year. You know, Chief's been trying. I realize that. We've had a lot of stones and rubber ties and things thrown in our yard. And the other day, I called one of your officers. Jared came down. He was looking at it. And recently, they've been throwing rocks. Chief was down there one night, right, Chief?
Last week,
my niece called. There was a problem with a gang of kids in the back. By the time the police came, they were gone. And I'm afraid, you know, that scrap along those rubber tracks, those kids put them on the tracks. You know, it's a good cause of an accident. And I just want to get a little proactive and, you know.
What's the protocol?
I can set up a meeting with Roman like you're the Roman.
I know we've talked to him, and I know one of the things we've asked him to do is not blow the horn at 11, 12 o'clock.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a whole other issue.
Very useful.
But, I had met with them down at the trestle, and we actually rent property from them at the storage area, so the real estate division is pretty easy for me to get to.
Okay.
So I can set something up, and then I'll let council know and if whomever wants to be there.
But this kids issue, you know, it's getting a little out of hand. My sister and all talk about it a little more.
Go ahead. I'm across from the church, and my backyard is close to the tracks. And I live with my father, and I have dogs, so I'm really alerted to anybody that's out in the front, which is also a problem because they like to be at the church because there's nobody there. And it's only me and the school and the church. So I hear them there often, and they're often on the street. And that has happened on any evening that's been not cold, in terms of if the weather gets nicer, even when in January when there were nice evenings. And these kids are not from this area, they're just coming from different sections, because when I ask them their names, of course they give me no names.
Yeah, of course.
And I don't recognize any of them.
Yeah.
And the tracks are where they had a clubhouse, and they told me that. So they go down there and they sort of make a clubhouse out of the ties and they collect things. So the noise is very difficult, and I'm up very early for work. Mm-hmm. And I try to ask them to, you know, take their activity someplace else, and they don't do that.
No.
So I thought maybe a curfew so that somebody could direct them to their homes.
We talked, Mike was here.
Here, tell me the, excuse me, Mike, what was it, a month ago? 5 weeks ago, when it was really nice,
mm-hmm.
12 o'clock midnight, front of the church.
Yeah.
And I asked Mary, she should have called the police, but she didn't.
Mm-hmm. Well, by the time I do, you know, by the time I'm talking to them, mm-hmm. you know, they exit.
They're disrespectful.
Yeah, I'm telling you nothing that you're surprised by.
Like I said, Mike was here a couple of
times. In the last summer, I guess.
Yeah. And we had a long discussion about it. You brought up a possible curfew, and I don't think that's something that we can do without the tent. It's kind of
Yeah, you have to rely on Tom for some of that, but it's always been my understanding, since we have a well-documented problem with juveniles. I mean, what you mentioned, although I understand, is a nuisance. It's not like we're getting felonies committed by these kids or even misdemeanors to that fact. It just seems to be that you don't like the fact they're on the road making noise to this point. So I don't know if that constitutes enough that we would want to implement a go to that major, but that's up to council ultimately for that. So
what is a misdemeanor?
We're not getting them committing any crimes. We understand you don't like the fact you hear noise coming from them or if they're on the street.
What about trespassing?
Well, who are they trespassing on whose property?
On the church. On the church.
Okay.
All over the church all the time.
If the pastor tells us he doesn't want them there, we'll look into enforcing that. And I'm sure it's going to drive up telling them to leave. Again, these aren't major issues. We're not having a town-wide issue with juveniles.
Not in some areas, but in others, yes.
I might add, some of those kids that she's talked to, I talked to as well. Some of them are from Heidelberg, some from Carnegie. They're not all local kids.
Right, that's what she was saying.
Yeah.
Perhaps once the debris is removed in the water, and if there's a clubhouse down there, maybe that can be looked into.
Sure.
If the clubhouse is found and perhaps just torn down without any big hoopla, just torn down, maybe they'll scatter.
I did that.
Did you?
And they were still there the next week.
Well, you got to get rid of the debris then, so they have nothing to use.
Yeah.
Where was the clubhouse? Where was it located?
It was right down buried in the section that
Coulter,
near
Coulter and station.
There are aerosol cans, there's alcohol cans. I picked up
a
lot of that.
I'm sure.
Because they're just really, making a mess down there. There's already a mess. But there's a lot of things that were down there. Before you walk over the trestle. Right there.
Yeah.
She
would be okay on me just to kind of check it out a little more. I mean,
sure, absolutely. This is the first I've heard of a clubhouse or
anything
like that.
Okay.
I mean, to that major. Is it right off the tracks from what I understand from what you're saying?
There's an area where they can sit before you walk over the trestle.
Oh, okay, down near the old salt pile down there.
Yeah, back this way.
Yeah.
And the debris they're throwing into the yard, that's not allowed, is it?
No, but again, I understand your concern.
Right.
My concern, being probably the guy that deals with this the most, we don't have a problem with juveniles in this town. Nothing like we did 15 years ago when we had a certain group
of
kids.
Well, we just don't want it to get any worse.
Right, and I understand, but we also can't say if you're from Carnegie or Heidelberg, you're not allowed at Bridgeville, just like we wouldn't want Carnegie and Heidelberg saying we don't want Bridgeville kids there.
Right. But you don't want them to feel that they can do whatever they want once they get there.
Absolutely, they won't do whatever they want when they want to do it, but they feel like doing it. But again, we have bigger problems. I mean, the kids aren't causing us headaches like they did 15 years ago, and we had a certain group that were just driving us nuts. I can tell you that from experience.
If I might, the issues with the railroad tracks, especially the stagnant water, have been plaguing us for a number of years. And I really can support Mike's comments that we need to do something. I like the idea of getting together with the railroad. But one of the things they came back to us the last time we asked them was that we don't have a quiet zone regarding the and if we're talking about noise,
that was a different individual than the individual that I talked to down there.
Right. I don't know what the requirements are, what council has to do to implement a quiet zone.
I can ask.
I have some information. I actually wrote that down, too, because I know there's been some.
Yeah.
Okay.
You know, if we're talking about noise, that's a real noisy problem when that train whistle goes off. And I don't know that it adds much to the safety. There's full crossing arms, and there's a full red light down there. It's something that we might be able to
do. It's almost like he does it on purpose. Yes, he
delays
it. I sit there in my island of buyers at 12:30 at night. I hear him thinking, I can't imagine being at
night. Right, I can't imagine that being in my backyard. You know? So I think that if we could find out, maybe that's something we can solve.
Yeah. City Colton.
Good evening, council, everyone. I'd like to introduce Mike Vinson, who's the president of the Bridgeville Athletic Association. I'm going to pass a couple of these pictures across to the council, and the rest of them will just be under operation. The only reason we're here tonight, and we will be very brief, is to ask permission to level that piece of ground that is shown in white. It's outlined in blue and shown in white, which if you go down into Chartiers Park, as soon as you get up to the, where the soccer fields are, that are mostly used by the St. Clair people, far into that soccer field, if you look at that picture, you can see where the fence is right there, that yellow fence, and outlined in white is where we want to just flatten the ground so that the little kids can have a place to practice their kegel. Nothing else.
I think that's Ed Snyder's property, isn't it? He owns property down there.
Like, what's the age of those players that play on that field?
3 and 4 years old. They are pretty deep ball players, but we just want to make a tiny little field that would be smaller than the smallest infield we have down in the park.
Would you want to move the road over a little bit to make it a little bigger or anything, or just?
The only thing we would really need to put up at this time is maybe some type of backstop, maybe just a 2 pieces of 6-foot fence, just so the ball doesn't go flying when the dads pitch it. Eventually, maybe some 2 benches, and maybe next year, try and fence the field in itself. But yeah, we just want to flatten it out, and just make a little field there.
Will you bring it up tonight?
The other, Dave, I believe you said you would do the.
We'll do everything we can. If council would be like, you find an extra $50 in your back pocket and give to us for topsoil or fencing, wonderful. If not, we'll make it flat and then we'll put a formal proposal.
Okay.
Okay.
Sounds good.
Thank you.
And next, I just made a list on those couple other things. The VA, a wish list. We'd like some help with this year, if possible. Several things I know that are big jobs, like the parking lot. I know I talked to Joe. He said he would like to work on that. I know that's not something you can just snap your fingers and
sure.
Fix the parking lot. The bathroom's on the Chargers Park. Every time we have a tournament, it's they end up clogging up or breaking. I don't know if there's something.
You know what our guys were just saying the other day, our public works director was just saying the other day that we have to stop putting paper towels in there because they just shove them down there and we're digging out paper towels out of those bathrooms. It's terrible to say, but we can't put them in the restrooms because they just get.
I second that motion. Get a big jug of Purell and put it in there.
Yeah.
Wipe it on your jeans.
Yeah. You would put hand towels in your tournaments for that reason.
Yeah.
And that's what's happening again. And then after they go down and dig out everything and they say, why are we still putting these in here? But they still put them in. So.
How often they suck it out down there?
How often do they suck it out down there?
Clean it up.
Well, the backer usually goes down once or twice a season. But it's not.
Maybe put some porta pots down there.
It's not that. It's whomever are shoving things down in our toilet. So if we don't put anything in there except some Purell, and hopefully the toilet paper, they won't shove that down in there. So what happens is they shove it down in, and then on Monday mornings we have the our guys are down there cleaning it out.
Fortunately, a lot of times it's after hours.
Yeah.
If you'll put down our new business tonight, you can get that taken care of.
Sure, thank you. Well, hold on, you've got to brag yourself a little bit about the pirates with the grant.
One of the items on there is we got an $8,400 grant from the pirates to build dugouts up at Cook School, which we'd like to start using more. Again, Dave is going to help us try and find the right people to do the work, and VA is going to pay for whatever else we need to finish the dugouts. Hopefully we can get that done before the season starts. We'd really like to use that field more.
guys do this, because we ran into this when we built our, restrooms up there, labor and industry, and we were chastised for not having a permit to build our own restrooms.
Okay.
So we certainly don't charge anything, but just make sure that we have a permit up there, because they'll be, I don't know how they find it, they came down.
I already talked to the Bridgeville Building Inspector about it, and I'll make sure that he's there on site when we put.
Yeah.
The dugouts?
Yeah, but they're.
They're not real big, I put a drawing in.
They're about 4 feet. So, you know, as far as just, you know, him looking at the drawings and then just issuing a permit, so there, there's no issue.
Sure, I'll make sure we do that.
Okay.
We'll keep you guys, whenever we go to do something, we'll contact you guys.
Thank you very much.
Bob Pryor.
Aye. The lines that you guys had painted on Barker Road to try and increase the number of cars stacking there to get through the intersection was a great idea. But because of that kink where the wheelchair ramp is in front of the building, it's impossible for a truck or a bus to get by there if there's another car sitting on the left lane, which there almost always is. And so what I did was, I just put some measurements to this to Joe the second. That wheelchair ramp could be moved to the side of your entrance porch out here. There's enough for them, I think, it's only 48 inches. And you could use the same handrail, the same bolting, the whole thing. But I just wanted to, excuse me, this isn't interrupting here. I'm going to leave that there. You can explain it there. The other thing is, last time I was here, last month, I had that large drawing that I showed you that, and what I was concerned about was there's a problem at the Bridgeville exit on the south bottom ramp that the vehicles are stacking back up around the ramp onto I-79 if they're coming to some of that fast lanes, which is a dangerous situation, obviously. So PennDOT asked the company by the name of, I think it's Taylor or McCormick or McCormick Taylor, I'm not even sure, to conduct a traffic study. And one of the specifications in the traffic study order was that they look into building another interchange at the west end of Boyce Road and South Fayette near the Alpine, Boyce Road Alpine Bridge there. I think I suggested the last time that you guys do everything possible to prevent that from happening and instead try to get the state to widen at a lesser cost. Washington Pike from Boyce Road, the four lanes down to Bridgeway and Bridgeville. I think I had that large drawing I wanted to show you. And at any rate, I don't know, did you guys even discuss this?
We do a little bit, but not, I mean, not in length.
Excuse me, I'm not only this as well. And then what I did was, I just roughed up a simple letter. And I can't stress to you the importance of your doing this. I forgot to mention what the problem is. In the study that they're conducting, they have an evaluation area, the perimeter in which the study will be done. It doesn't include Barber Hill Road and Bridgeville, or Station Street in Bridgeville, which is Mayview Road. And you're talking about Barber Hill Road and Station Street and Chartier Street. They handle a total of 30,000 cars a day there. And primarily, you know, most of them go to the Bridgeville exit and back. And for some reason, our streets weren't included in the study, and that makes me really nervous. So I just wrote the letter for you that primarily says, today in Cessna, considering the nearly 30,000 vehicles a day that come on the Washington Pike and Bridgeville Central Business District, from Barber Hill Road, Station Street, which is an extension of Mayview Road, and Chartier Street, which is an extension of Lesnut Road, and that these three intersections are less than 1,000 yards from the Bridgeville exit of I-79, the site of the traffic congestion that you have asked the study for, and we are requesting that you expand the evaluation area of the traffic study to include the three intersections in Bridgeville.
Who's we?
You guys.
He's writing that, okay.
Yeah, I can do.
Or be happy that he thinks that you just said.
Yeah, I was gonna say. Right, well, you guys can discuss this.
I'm not arguing here, Bob, here's the thing, if the contract that PennDOT has with McCormick Taylor is only to study I-79, and that's the addition of a third lane between the new Southern Expressway and the Kerwin Heights interchange, okay? That's all within the confines of 79 itself. They have data from people's cell phones, they've been tracking for 2 years as to where people go. Anything that's regarding Washington Avenue, Chartier Street, is something that the Bower Hill Road, that was looked at with the Southville study that they gave us a preview of back in early January. Okay, so they have yet to provide final copies of any of that information to anybody. And once we get a copy of it, we can more than glad we'll sit down and we'll go over it with you. But they're only going to give people pieces of it. They're not going to give us the whole book. And I think they said the whole book was going to be like 5 or 6 inches thick. So there's a lot of information going on out there that depend on Bob. And I think when Lori and I went to this meeting with regards to I-79, there was a breakdown in communication internal to PennDOT. I'm not trying to throw them under the bus. But what we brought to them, well, they did not know that there was work going on with the Route 50 task force.
It was a different group of people.
Different group of people. Yeah, so we explained everything to them and, you know, tried to help educate them on what was going on. So I'm not sure that Dan Cessna is going to want to be expanded the scope of this work on 79. And these are things that we're looking at with the Route 50 task force.
Joe, I'd like to politely disagree with that. I got a copy of the actual order of PennDOT that they issued to Taylor McCormick, and it very specifically cites consider another interchange at the intersection of Alpine, we're using the Alpine Road Bridge that's already constructed over I-79,
okay.
And primarily from what the details of the order that I got a copy of.
Do you bring it with you, Bob?
No, but I'll be glad to get
I'd like to
Lori
see
tomorrow. No,
I'd like to see a copy of that.
No, I'll be glad to. Okay. But I just want to mention again, the reason that it's essential that you guys prevent an interchange like that being built on your original Suffolk interchange is because it will detour 75% of the commuter motorists away from
consumer motorists.
What did I just say?
You said commuter motorists.
No, I didn't say consumer motorists. You're using my paper correct. What I was going to say is, so now that that's what right is, the average commuter in the country going from, I guess, home to work and back again every day, they spend $2,600 a year buying stuff in the communities they drive through. If you take a look at the makeup of Safiad's business district, that's exactly what it is. It's gasoline, oil, breakfast, dropping off cars at Vitus Butler. You can't even consider allowing that huge group of consumers not to be able to drive through Richmond and South.
Gotcha.
So I might mention what one final thing. Ever since I-79 was built, the Safiad Bridge on McCollier, the Route 19 business districts in Upper St. Clair and Mount Lebanon lost 50,000 consumer motorists a day. Since then, they've made more than one attempt to try to get their consumer motorists back. There were hundreds of businesses that just disappeared from that corridor when that happened. The South Hills Village Mall has been bought and sold 3 times since that happened. My point is, there's been a formal request sent to by the county to the state and federal government, to connect the Kerwin Heights interchange with Painters Run Road to detour all that traffic corridor around the Collier Bridge intersection. And the same group of people that are behind these detour efforts have already proposed the Boyce Road interchange on I-79 going over to Route 19. You've got to protect it's, I'm talking about the financial stability of bridge recording and stuff, that you've got to act.
I disagree.
You know, I'm just going to play devil's advocate.
Okay, no, sure.
Real quick here.
Yeah, sure.
I don't want, you know, we don't need to discuss this. It's discussed a lot. These are obviously your, you know, you think that we should get all these consumer letters through Brick Builder.
That's right.
A lot of people don't want there to be a funnel of just cars just pouring in there and bottlenecking right down the main core, the main drive. We've said it before, we know we have an issue with traffic in this town. The idea that I think a lot of people agree on isn't we want to make every car come through Bridgeville. We want to make it easy for people to come to Bridgeville, park, and use our business.
Do you know it's a fundamental traffic problem, isn't it?
What?
You have a 4-lane road coming in the east side of the community,
into a 2-lane,
and you have a 2-lane bottleneck in between. Six different city planners and engineers have told me how to solve the problem. And that's to just build a two-way couple using the existing streets that you have here. No middle lane is going to help. So what I was going to say was by the two-way couple, by the way, combined with the 4-lane widening of the bike and stop, you eliminate the traffic congestion. And you're right, you increase the number of cars coming through town, it would be coming through 20 miles an hour. Well, not under total control.
All right.
So that is more true.
I understand. Thanks.
All right. Sure.
Can you put yourself?
Jeez, I don't even say anything, but if it's an owner, come after the perfect crap. But it's too bad. I really like it. It is an owner.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear what you said.
It's okay, I'll say that. You will know it. You know, I actually don't want to say anything. At the end, I mean, I say, well, maybe it's just that. I heard quite a few things over here. Some is concerned zoning. And I'm going to go in for that. I don't want to tonight, but now we have a banker, we have an accountant, we have a board manager, which she has a gift about math. She's probably going to be the butcher. Now, everybody's talking about this damn building that's going to be five stores. Now, if we do the math, each store, I'm going to do it geometry, unfortunately. If you take the square feet of that, of both this floor that people don't want, we lose money because real estate will be less, maybe employees less. Think about making money for this borough. Never mind of five stores or six stores. We need room. We don't have ground. We have to go up. Do you understand in front of the post office, they're talking about designing? Did you ever stop in front of the post office? And you look all the way up the PNC. Look like roller coaster design. So which roof you want to meet? Which facade you want to meet? Take a look there. Look there. It's like this. Mm-hmm. I guess they blind a horse in those days, and wherever you went, they put a building. They did that in my own time, too, many years ago. Police. I've been talking about zoning for less 3 years. On one-on-one with Mrs. Carlin. Some things she agreed, some things she disagreed. But that's normal, that's healthy. Now we have Carol come in, we have our solicitor here involved with this. Oh, what we design, what we propose is good for other municipality. These people don't know Bridgeville, believe me. We have to do what's good for Bridgeville. They use other example. You have to take the Mickey Mice out of the way. It's my word. Everybody's quote me on that. Make the people, of course you will have a control. You should have a control. Because a lot of things, you know, you go to the zoning. Make it so you go to the planning commission, with the proper design with engineer and the zoning officer, let them come to you guys and study if it's good or bad for Bridgeville.
Right.
Take a lot of Mickey Mice out of the way. If we lose this cycle, this is a very good cycle. Otherwise, I'm like Donald Trump now. He looked like Benito Mussolini. I was in those days. More than I did. You know, I'm like, your sense of humor.
I agree.
Take things for experience. Experience. You don't have to pay anything. I've been involved with this time since I was 21. We could own all the way to Boys Road. Oh no, we won't leave Bridgeville the way it is. This is a country club. We're going to set all the family more money. We don't want nothing. A long time before council. I was 21 years old when my uncle Nick Romano built it. We could have the shopping center. There was an airport. Maybe West can testify that. She's been into that. They don't want to do nothing with Bridgeville. They want to leave it the way it is. Please, don't do that. Don't do that. Do it to bring money. That's what you gotta do. Of course, you gotta have control. No question. Lord knows where I'm standing on that. Very well. You know, we need the stamp of Carroll because for the grant and everything. You know what I told Lori one time? You know, Lori, you and I, council, could do a better job on this goddamn design they're doing, on this zoning. But we know what the hell Bridgeville is. Trust me. These people don't know Bridgeville. They compare us with Mount Lebanon, Edgewood, this and that. This is Bridgeville. Bring the money in by being in control of what's happening. Please. Don't let me hear that again. I heard it from 16 years. Okay?
Okay.
The reason I come here, so Bob is right a lot of things. I mean, I know I made a mistake for 30 years, but that wasn't the only one. You think I'm gonna see Penny leave Bridgeville? I was delegate on the Bridgeville corridor. Well, the traffic was bad, but we had one car garage there, then two car garage. Now they built on six car garage. Of course the traffic gets more. Tell Bob to give you the marking mini car goes at 40 years ago in today. Probably triple, 10 times. Of course we need the water. We definitely don't need four lane in the middle of Washington Avenue. We need a bypass, just like Mercedes here. Bypass, top on top from Collier to 79. Or the railroad, talk about the railroad, it's perfect to go to 79. It takes time, we know that. Work on constructive. You know, I need people, Bridgeville, they worry about five-story building. To me, it doesn't matter. I'm anyone there. I don't give a damn if it's 5-store, 10-store, 1-store. It can help me. I like things go good for Bridgeville, for the future Bridgeville. Open your eyes when the zoning comes in front of you. Make it easy for the builder. To who, doesn't matter who it is. Whether it's his brother, whether it's my brother, whether it's your father, it doesn't matter who the hell built, okay? We want more money coming in. And he can tell you, he's a banker. Money is never enough for them. That's what it should be.
What does that have to do with anything?
Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Believe me. I'm making an example. Money.
Well, that's fine, but
yeah, I understand no interpretation to that. But anyway, if you heard a week ago, I don't make it the way you take it. Maybe my speech is a little bit different. I think different. You notice the little town of Flynn problem with the water. The governor didn't do anything. The federal didn't do anything. The council people didn't do anything. The mayor didn't do anything. We have 0% of what happened over there. And our board engineer and Lori, they're on the ball. Believe me, I work with these people. Leave them alone. They know you. But there's some unconstructed people over here. They do a lot of work. And people call here, call there, they make them go back and lose time. She has they have a great respect with PennDOT. They have a good respect with the municipalities over here, the neighbors' municipalities. Leave them alone. They have to come in front of you.
Right.
They're not going to say yes.
I know that.
Let them get to the damn things together. They know what they're doing, believe me. I spend a lot of time with that. I still call Joe. He don't build me, he don't build you guys either. Because I have a lot of things in my mind. And I don't mind to share my experience. Experience has been cheap for you guys. So all I gotta say, big constructor, people talks, big constructor. Everybody wants this town to be better. The traffic, yes, we have a bad traffic. Mary say 5 o'clock in the morning when she goes to work. First we can work naked around that time, you know, but it's you. But try to do the quick time or you travel, you go on vacation, or a little town there like this. But it can be done. Boys Road, we fought with Boys Road for years. I don't know why Boys Road never was done. Boys Road should be done. They would eliminate a lot of traffic. You guys doing a good job with the task force. That's going to help a lot of traffic? No. What the hell? Because they can move. They have a place to move. A day from now, it's going to be obsolete. When I was with the Jesse's, the park we were just open, you know that town will come after that, in case you don't know. I, 22-year-old, I told PennDOT, if you don't make the whole under Western Avenue, this is going to be obsolete. 2 years later, they make the whole under Western. So, I know we don't think vision. We don't have a vision sometimes. Not only us, everybody has that. Thank you for listening to me. I'm sorry. I don't mean for the way you take it. You're professional. You know, I know my language, you know, you say God, so I don't mean that way. What do we do without the banks? The banks got me what I am. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to me.
I'll be easy on Joe and Lori.
All right. We will be moving on now. Minutes. Motion of the Borough Council regarding the minutes of February 8, 2016, regular meeting as submitted.
So moved.
That'll be Bill Henderson and Bill Pelosi. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion of the Borough Council regarding the minutes of February 22, 2016, special meeting as submitted. Joe Ricci and Ellen Cole. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. 2016 pavement maintenance program. Motion of the Borough Council authorizing engineer sites to prepare specifications for the 2016 pavement maintenance program and manager Collins to advertise the same. List of streets include in the 2016 projects are as follows. Harding Street from Lesnut Road to Terminus, 50% of the cost to be paid by the Pennsylvania American Water Company. Forbes Street from Harding Street to Coolidge Street, 50% of cost be paid by Pennsylvania American Water Company. Union Street from Bar Hill / Bluff intersection to Terror Street. Funds available for this year's project, $158,000. So Calusi and Bill Henderson. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Ordinance number 989. A motion of the Borough Council regarding ordinance number 989, an ordinance amending the Borough of Bridgeville Code of Ordinance, Chapter 15, Motor Vehicles and Traffic, Part 4, General Parking Regulations 15-402, parking prohibited at all times in certain locations, specifically on to prohibit parking in certain locations and to authorize parking in certain locations on Bank Street extensions. This ordinance will permit the placement of 6 parking spaces on the southerly side of Bank Street extension as requested by the parking authority. The ordinance has been duly advertised.
So moves.
So Henderson and Joe Clausimo. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Ordinance number 990. A motion of the Borough Council regarding ordinance number 990. An ordinance amending the Borough of Council Code of Ordinances, Chapter 15, Motor Vehicles and Traffic, Part 10, Parking Authority Rates, Rules, and Regulations, 15-1002.1. On street parking to authorize the parking authority to install and maintain metered parking spaces at specified locations on Bank Street extension. The ordinances have been duly advertised.
So moved.
Bill Henderson?
Second.
And Joe Clausen. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Current estimate number 2, 2015 lining contract B. A motion of the Borough Council regarding the remittal of current estimate number 2, 2015 lining contract B to Jet Jack Incorporated in the amount of $27,363.60 with the work completed to date. The current estimate has been reviewed by engineer sites. Bill Calusi and Bill Henderson. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Current estimate number 3 and final, 2015 lining contract B. Motion of the Borough Council regarding the remittal of current estimate number 3 and final, 2015 lining contract B to Jet Jack Incorporated in the amount of $27,026.12 for the final work completed. The estimate has been reviewed by engineer sites. Bill Calusi.
I'll say it.
Bill Henderson. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Current estimate number 3 and final, 2015 CCTV project. A motion of the Borough Council regarding the remittal of current estimate number 3 and final, 2015 CCTV project to Insight Pipe Incorporated in the amount of $3,033.53 for the final work completed. The estimate has been reviewed by engineer sites.
So moved.
Joe Plasmo and Bill Calusi. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Current estimate number 4 and final 2014 CCTV project. Motion Borough Council regarding the remittal of current estimate number 4 and final 2014 CCTV project to Jet Jack Incorporated in the amount of $14,800.12 for the final work completed. The estimate has been reviewed by engineer sites. Bill Calusi.
I'll second.
And Joe Lucci. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. First Energy LED streetlight conversion agreement. A motion of the Borough Council authorizing the termination of the contract with First Energy for the current mercury vapor and high pressure sodium streetlights and approving a contract on a month-to-month basis for the conversion of the streetlights to Cobra Head LED lighting. First Energy owns 400 streetlights within the borough of Bridgeville. The conversion will reflect a savings of 30 to 50% in lighting costs per year, which calculates to an approximate dollar savings of $26,000.
So moved. Second.
Joe Gucci and...
Nina,
listen to this. Lori, great job saving us $26,000.
Yes, Pat.
Yeah.
Minor, the contract that we're moving into for the LEDs, I'm just reading that, is it a 10-year?
It's a 10-year, but you can give them notification. What it is it's a 10-year contract, which is what we've always had with them. But they want a letter, of which I think I included it on my... in my paperwork, it states that Bridgeville Borough would like to terminate the contract for its mercury vapor and high pressure sodium street lights according to the provisions of each contract, but would like to continue service on a month-to-month basis. The month-to-month continuation can be ended by either party with a 30-day written notice. So even though it's a 10-year contract, with a 30-day written notice, either of us can terminate.
And that has to go with the contract. So, motion by Joe, and second by Bill Henderson. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Bill List. Motion to the Borough Council regarding the March 2016 bill list. So, a little Lucy and the last one. All those in favor?
Aye.
Motion carries. Payrolls. Motion to the Borough Council approving the payrolls of March 18, 25, and April 1 and 8, 2016. Joe Gucci and Bill Lucy. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Monthly reports. A motion to accept and pay any commissions due the February 2016 real estate tax collector report.
So moved.
Bill Henderson.
Second.
And Joe Costino. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion to accept the January 2016 financial report.
So moved.
Joe Rucci.
Second.
Bill Henderson. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion to accept February 2016 police report.
So moved.
Who's that? Bill Henderson and Bill Pelosi. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Motion to accept February 2016 zoning report.
So moved.
Bill Henderson?
Second.
And Joe Pelosi. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Real estate tax refund. A motion of the Borough Council regarding the following real estate tax refund due to a change in the assessment as requested by the real estate tax collector. Year 2015, lot block 255-F-225 for the amount of $1,590.05 to Charles Horan. Year 2014, lot block 255-F-225 for $1,590.05 to Charles Moran. Year 2013, lot block 255-F-225 for $1,590.05 for a total of $4,770.15 to Charles Moran. Copy of the official change orders have been attached to your request. Joe Ricci.
No, sir.
And Bill Henderson. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed? Motion carries. Committee report. Bruce is not here. Finance. Joe.
A week or so I met with Lori, and she was nice enough to give me some time to answer many, many questions, but to help me understand the way the borough handles their finances. And our funds are where we expect them to be at this time of year. That's all I have.
Thanks very much, Joe. Parks and Rec.
Thanks, Mike. Last week I attended a meeting up at the Chargers Valley High School. They had called us and requested a representative from all the member boroughs and townships. what they're looking at, they're breaking ground, I guess, this spring on a new high school, middle school complex up there. And what's going to happen, not this year, but next year, the girls' softball field's going to be gone. So next year, they're looking for fields where they might be able to have the high school softball games on. And they want to know what fields were available. I talked to Joe Ducci about it. He's not here, but between all the municipalities, there's plenty of fields that we'll be able to help the high school out. So it would sort of be nice, I guess. Back in the day when I was with the VA, we had a lot of kids play for the high school team. And it'd be nice if they could go around to each municipality, but it's a year away, and hopefully we'll be able to work something out with them. They were also interested in the lines of communication between the boroughs and the school district, and between our newsletter and Lori's in contact with them all the time. They're happy with this, so that was a good thing. Got to meet a couple borough managers. And Collier has their own
Parks and Rec person.
Parks and Rec person, right? It was a little old beat up car from the borough. It was cool. Newsletter deadline, April 6th. The next newsletter, get the information to the borough or Deb. That's all I have on Parks.
Thank you, Joe. Public Works.
Okay. It seems like you're getting the parks. I'm looking in the parks and all over the bridge and all this. They're holding their own, I guess.
Yes.
All right.
Public Safety, go ahead.
Yeah. This morning at the agenda meeting, we talked a little bit about the police contract and we left the clause open for presentation of the potential for the drop pension, and that open clause is nearing an end. So we're going to. I'd like to make a motion to extend the open clause that deals with the drop pension presentation portion of that for 60 days, which would take that to at the end of May.
Yes,
and we will have a presentation prior to our next meeting. From the drop pension expert that the police had hired. So that's a form of a motion.
All right. And then I'll second it.
Okay.
He made the motion.
Right. Okay.
All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Motion carries.
That's all right.
All right. Thank you very much. Going back to Joe, since it's under Parks and Recs, would you want to make a motion?
Oh, about the field?
Yeah, my vacation under Parks and Rec.
Yeah, I make a motion to permit the BAA to grade out that little area at the end of the soccer field for the purpose of building a small t-ball area for the kids.
Excellent.
I'll second that.
Those in favor? All those opposed? Motion carries. Thank you, Joe. Mayor, Pat?
A couple of items that have come up in the discussion. On the parks, if there's any thoughts perhaps of looking at Triangle Park, I know that there have been some plans there to do some work on the shrubbery and the areas around Triangle Park as we come into the spring. I don't know if there are any plans to look at that. I know that I've been contacted two or three times.
We've been contacted by a resident that regarding adding some shrubs to the hillside, and
yeah.
The hillside is not, that's not ours. Mm-hmm. That belongs to Northwest Savings Bank. Yes, so that's why we don't touch the hillside. I mean, mm-hmm. We could always ask them if they do something with it, but. That's why we don't touch the hillside over there.
So that's our impediment then?
Yes. We don't know.
The information to be able to pass back. Okay. You know, if we can get some grass and topsoil in that, the bare areas.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you. The issues with Ridge Road and Cook School and some of the other items that that we were looking at, that Carolyn Yeagle was reporting. I believe she's somewhat wrapping up. Am I correct, Lori?
Yes, she'll have, I think she'll probably have something for council to review in the next month or so.
I would hope that we would continue the progress on those items. Perhaps even considering, you know, requests for proposals to see what it would, what the costs would be as we move forward with it. On the LED streetlights, Lori,
yes.
My concern there is with Allegheny Power.
Mm-hmm.
And we looked at having anyone else bid on those. I know that Homestead and some other municipalities and the city of Pittsburgh did it instead of giving it to Allegheny Power. And it's true. Since it's month to month, you know, we can maybe take a look at that and
It doesn't cost us anything for them to install them, unless it's some kind of unusual light. But as far as them installing the Cobra heads, and what they'll be doing is they'll be installing something that is, say it's a 200 volt light, I'm just saying, what? Yeah, sorry. They'll be installing something that is comparative to that, but which gives a lot more lighting. So it seems to me that it's a no-brainer as far as it's no cost to us. If we decide that down the road we want to go with a provider that is less expensive, we can get a 30-day and be out and go with them. But through all of that, First Energy owns our land. They own them. So, there's no cost. And as far as they know, we do not have any oddball lights here. So there won't be any cost as far as them transitioning the motor to LED. So, you know how the specials come around and they say, we did that for a while. We sign on to a lighting agreement for a while and got some lower rates, and now that lighting agreement has come up to the First Energy rates, which usually is what happens.
But with these lights, is actually a result of the managers and some municipal groups lobbying them to accelerate the pace at which they switch these things over from the old dinosaur technology to the big electric bill and the really efficient lights. That's really a great thing.
Oh, it's absolutely. I stand with everyone else saying thank you for moving this forward.
Yeah, it's great to get in early. Yes. Just because I think North End and South End are in, and then we're in, and so they can, they can get these things in as soon as possible and save us some money. And like I said, we'll know exactly what they are, where they are, what grid they're on, what section of town is done, and then hopefully we won't have streetlights out as often either, because they're not.
That is the big item. It's hopefully they won't go out as much.
And if you want to think about it, if there's any area of town that you feel needs additional lighting, they can do that also. So, this isn't going to happen for a while.
Now, I'll tell you where it's up. Where you have the gas lines that you built around that apartment complex?
Yes.
You know what I'm talking about?
I know where
it is. Right on the back of that street. Yeah, we have Jersey Barry. Right on the back of that back street, there's a pole. I have a pole number. And they've been asking for one of the really great people out there.
Yeah, they said to let them know.
Yeah.
And we are going to finally get those two lights taken down over the railroad street parking lot. But if there were any areas where we thought that were a little darker, although they're going to be more lit, but we need to light somewhere.
Anything else, Pat?
That's all.
Thank you very much. Police Chief, Jack King.
No report other than it's
to my opinion, we don't need a curfew at this time for juveniles.
No problem. Thank you very much. Solicitor, Tom Carroll.
Yeah, my report on there.
Your sites.
Thank you, Mr. President. Quite a few guys on my report have already been checked with the agenda items. Just an update here on the McLaughlin Run Park Phase 2 grant. Last week, we received communication from Alex Tanish, who indicated he needed some more documentation for the land and water conservation fund paperwork that he needs to submit to the National Park Service, who has provided the funds for the grant. So we're working on that this week, and we'll get that to him so he can finish his submission to them. Thank you for approving the 2016 pavement maintenance program. We'll get the bids advertised and taken prior to the April meeting, and hope to make a recommendation for awarding that part. The Washington Street sanitary sewer repairs are moving along quite well. I've had a few hiccups here and there, but nothing that we could overcome with that. And I see that the water company is only about halfway done with their work with the new water line that's being installed on Washington Avenue. One thing that I did notice, and Lori and I talked about this, was some of the restoration that's going to need to be done to our streetscape since they've removed some of it for the new services to service some of the buildings on Washington Avenue. I will be getting with the contractor, Casper Pomosimo, and provide them with the details along our construction drawings when we do our streetscape so they can restore it in kind. And then we have a meeting next week for the Route 50 corridor task force. And so that we hopefully will give the council an update at the April meeting. So that's all I have.
Great. Thank you very much. Fire Chief Pacilio.
Thanks, Mr. President. Just a few things here. One, thanks for everybody coming down for the fish fries. We have one more left on Good Friday. They've been doing really good. Also, we have the Easter egg hunt coming up on the 26th, next Saturday. That'll be down in Tarchers Park in that first pavilion area when you come down. So the BAAs down there won't be interfering with them. They should be okay. Last year was a huge success with doing it down there because the kids had more room to run and get them. So that's on its way. Two, our tickets are for sale and available for the Cash Bash coming up. I know a lot of people look forward to that first Saturday of May, which is the 7th. So get your tickets because they're starting to sell pretty good now. It's a tradition. And last, in our COG, we are scheduling instructors to come in throughout the summer and probably fall. We'll be doing a lot of weekend classes next door at the building that Borough has. We're going to be bringing instructors in from all over the country to do over there. Plus, we're trying to coordinate something with the police later in the year, hopefully, if we can work something up. Is hopefully like an active shooter, being that's becoming a common thing in both in the line of service, you know, with the three of us, just becoming more and more. You know, it's not just for the police, you know, the fires, there's been enough shootings just at firemen do now. So it's something we're talking about that we want to really work with the police about. So, but that's about it. Thanks.
Southbridge EMS came to the report. I don't think Beck is here. Nobody's here from the library.
Does our Taste of the Town, I believe, is April 9th? April 9th.
I provided a report if anybody has any questions. The only thing that I did want to note that I didn't place on the report is I in contact with Pennsylvania American Water Company about the large amount of delinquencies that we're experiencing with our sewage billing. With them, we've got approximately $89,000 outstanding right now, which is unheard of. When we were collecting, we probably kept it between $12,000 and $15,000. So I've asked them to address that, or we would start addressing it. So as of today, $28,000 in sewage charges were going to go to homes. Were going to the waters were going to be shut off today. And these are houses that they sent me the list, and they are $1,200, $1,500. We never let them get up that high. And when they get that high, it's impossible for people to pay them. So I think we're going to have to look at something. And if we have to get involved in collections, we'll do that. But when I saw the list, it was just kind of a little disappointing, because there's no way that the normal individual can, if they can't pay the sewage bill, they can't pay an $1,800 sewage bill.
We pay them to do the collections?
We're paying them to do the collections. And I've addressed this before with them, and they started to send out delinquencies, and they started to shut off water. But over the past 6 months, I have seen no difference. When I get my listing, it is always between $80,000 and $90,000 outstanding, which we can't afford that. We've got sanitary sewer projects and bills that are, you know, on our bill list that we've got to pay, and that's money just sitting out there. So
they're really that same amount of arrearage on the water bills on the same houses.
They may be getting their cash. I didn't ask them, but as far as, you know, when we build the sewage, we never had issues like this. So that's what
process to eliminate that, or to change.
Well, you know, whether we can change collectors, which whether we can bring it back, try to bring it back in house. We do have software to do that. It was just that it would take one person specifically to do that job. You know, with the staff that we had, it wasn't working. It was cheaper to send it out, but we're not getting the results that we should get.
What's the appropriate point that someone's water should be shut off? When they have 2 months delinquent, three?
What we would normally do would be, let's say for instance garbage. Mm-hmm. What we do is we send out notifications, and when garbage is 2/4 delinquent, mm-hmm. we send out notifications, because that's 6 months, mm-hmm. and then give them a chance to make payment arrangements. And then if we hear nothing, we give them a date. They're going to the magistrate, and mm-hmm. we do the same thing. They had told me that they were sending things out for anything over $150. But they can't be the case, because I got a list of $150.
How many houses in Bridgeville right now have their water turned off because they're not paying their sewer?
I couldn't tell you that right
any?
Now. Yes.
Okay,
yes.
So you do have some.
What happens is they bill the property owner, and we get that money, and then we in turn have to pay Pennsylvania American Water Company the money for the shutoff and
right.
the return home. So they do it, but not enough.
No, that's where I think the issue is. They're not doing it enough.
No.
And I think if we tell them, you know, again, this is council that's, you know, saying, hey, we're going to shut off your water if you're 3 months delinquent. Or what did you say, $150?
No, normally what we would do would be, because some people have $5 sewage bills. Some people mm-hmm. have $200 sewage bills, whatever. But we would normally say between $150 and $200, because we knew when we got to that point that it then began to be hard for them to pay it. And we worked with them, we made payment arrangements with them, and I'm just not...
It sounds like the follow-up is dropped.
Yeah, absolutely. And when I called again and said, hey, I'm still looking at $89,000 outstanding, and so then they sent me a list of who they were going to shut off, and when I got the totals, I was dumbfounded.
Mm-hmm. So. Because they're not shutting off at the level
we feel that they should.
For us to communicate to them, that's the level.
Yeah.
If you're over $150, if you're over that level, you're getting a water shut off.
I did it once. apparently we're going to have to make it really clear because it
they
just,
think so.
Because it's
yeah, that's that rigidity needs to be, obviously there are extenuating circumstances.
Right, and we work with
in general, that's the limit, that's the cutoff point.
Right.
And it also makes it very easy if that's what you've established.
Right.
And then people know how far they can push it.
That's right.
You know, you gotta, because it costs money to turn your water back on.
It's $30 for it to be sent in to shut up, be turned off, and it's $30 for it to be turned back on. So it's $60 on top of what you already owe.
Right.
So I know we got, today was the final day, and we got one payment of for over $1,000 today.
Mm-hmm.
Because normally what happens is when they're gonna shut off, they'll bring them here. And we'll just call in and say it's here. And there were probably 25. So if they sent them in there or made arrangements, I don't know. I'll check tomorrow, but.
That's gonna solve
it.
Yeah, that's gonna solve it right there.
So that's a concern of mine, and I'll keep you updated on it.
Okay. Anything else?
That's
all right. Whole business.
Mr. Chairman, I have to ask Lori and I'll become like Paul, Mr. Paul, and say, wait, I have something else. Now, I'm looking at the money available for the street. And we have 50% paid by the water company, and 50%, blah, 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 blah. So the senator already read that. And the engineer and you made a lot of this legal deals. Let's put it legal. You did a lot of partnership with this, and the taxpayers should appreciate it. But you have some money left.
Well, money left, but we have engineering, advertising.
Well, I figured to do it on the street. You know what I mean.
We only have about $10,000 left.
Save it for next year.
Yes.
If you need some for public court, use it.
Well, $10,000 won't.
You can do that.
Yeah, that won't cover engineering.
Maybe you need some money for the trash that Mr. Colucci has so many volunteers. I haven't seen anybody. And the rain is going to come soon. Maybe, and I know you're very busy. You don't need that now. Maybe you and the engineer and public work to get together on that and put it for bait, because that trash is very important. Was a good idea for Bill. But if you can't get volunteered, you should have mentioned it. Let to do legal, let to do the right way. And I want to immediately strike out on the minutes, the banker. They don't have nothing to do with Mr. my friend here. He gave a lot of time with the kids. And his wife worked with the kids, they have a beautiful job. I don't mean that way. If we have a doctor that's on the board, it's good. He can help us for the help. The scheme, perhaps.
Yeah.
I meant that he deal with number, with math. If you follow me, what I was saying, you understand. If you, that's what I meant. But that should be straight out. Absolutely.
Okay. Show you.
Thank you. Police. They made a good choice.
Right. I got something
for you. They made a good choice when they hire you. Please strike that out.
You know what? Bill Bott just came to me last week and he said, "Floor." Floor. As soon as we're done with their clearance of debris along the street, he said they'll get going. They actually talked to my Cheeto regarding what would be the most cost-effective way to do the railing on the stairs, and they're
going to
do this.
All right. Okay. Yeah, they're ready. I don't know if the railing's going to do it, but that's...
They're going to try to do... They looked at it, and they said, you know... Try to do the landings. Move the railing over to the other side because the one side's worse than the other, and then you know, just try to patch them, because I think right now people are going down and using
it. I know we have to get closed, but
people are still going to use them, they're not there.
So if we can try to do something to make them, and maybe put, you know, get some estimates and for next year's budget to put new ones in.
Okay, yeah, that's what I was going to say. We could look at it, see different, a couple different ways of your wood, you know, replacing the prefab step or just form whatever. Any new business?
Yes, sir. Yeah, I got, excuse me, a couple of things I want to bring up. I talked to Lori about this, but it still bothers me a little bit. That situation we had with Jeff Jack and letting them out of their contract, they sort of got off scot-free, but the borough got stuck for some costs, such as I guess Tom had to do some research on some of those things, and Joe had to do some
re-advertise
the... Right. Now, it's probably minuscule. I think Corey said it's about $1,000. That's the taxpayers that are paying that. Mm-hmm. Lori said that all the time she's been here, that's the first time that that's ever happened. But I don't want it to happen again. Is there a way of preventing that? Is something in our bids or anything like that?
If I might speak to that?
Yeah.
It's an infrequent event anywhere. I don't know that I've had one in another municipality that I've dealt with, but what we did, sometimes we have to act like a judicial body. We actually did not have any choice except to entertain that. And we didn't let anybody out of the contract, okay? They filed a request pursuant to the statute that specifically authorizes them to do that. We put them through their paces, made them meet a burden of proof, actually made them submit supplemental, actual original materials to show the legitimacy of the claim. And when there is, under the law, if somebody can actually prove that they made a substantial error that was math-based, et cetera, along the lines we spoke about before, they actually have a legal right to be allowed out of the contract without the penalty of losing their bid bond. By the way, we can't indenture servitude people. We didn't actually let them out of the contract. What we let them out was we allowed them to withdraw their bid without losing the 10% bid bond penalty. So, and unfortunately, if we're presented with that situation and somebody meets their burden of proof of making the submission, we're compelled, actually.
How much did it cost us to do the waiver?
I'm not sure yet.
Why don't you figure it out and send Jack a bill? I'm sure he'll.
Again, you just heard
me say it. Let's go.
Anything else,
John? I felt given our legal obligations, is that U.S. and I understand we have a meters running on these things as well. And frankly, the thought occurred to me that we don't have the statutory authority to collect on our judicial costs or quasi-judicial costs related to that. We will.
I guess back in February, the borough gave the opportunity, the Boroughs Association had a couple days of classes regarding for new officers, townspeople and whatnot. And I had been on before, but that, it was good for like a refresher course. And a big part of the session, one of the sessions was conduct, the way the meetings are conducted. Time, length of speakers and whatnot. And they always say that you should have a set of rules regarding people. Now, Bridgeville's a little different than a small town. I mean, other than meetings at Upper St. Clair and Collier and whatnot, and they run it like Bloomingville.
Right.
But here it's a little bit different. And sometimes I believe here things do get a little out of hand as far as the speakers. So, I mean, I don't want to stop anybody from talking, but I mean, we've had discussions about this before.
Joe, I understand what you're saying. And we try to, keep, and I'm sorry, Bob, I'm going to use you as an example because you're here pretty much every meeting. And if Bob's bringing something up that, we feel we've gone over, like he came up today and he started talking about the Boyce Road intersection. That's the first time he's brought that up to a meeting.
Right.
So I felt compelled to let him state what he had to say about the intersection because that hasn't been brought up yet.
Right.
And the traffic study with 79, that hasn't been brought up. But if he would have went on about
you know, widen the bridge. I would say, Bob, you know, we have a conceptual drawing. You know, we've already talked about this right now. We're not going to go into it. And then, you know, I'll use another example because everybody's here. Mary Wise comes up. She's going to talk about the Historical Society. I'm not going to stop Mary Wise from talking about the Historical Society. I don't think anybody up here is going to. So, I mean, Nino's going to come up here. Is somebody going to stop Nino from talking? No, it's granted, yes. If somebody's going to start and, you know, keep going on and on, yes, I will try to curb them. But I do not, when I've talked to, you know, the solicitors, he's told me the same thing. You know, you could stop these people right now. Yeah, I know I could. I know I could do that. But again, we're not Upper St. Clair. We're not Mount Lebanon.
Right.
We're, you know, and if somebody wants to, you know, if somebody's not on the list and they want to get up and say something and interject, I'm going to let them go.
I agree with you. That's just, they could bring that up.
For example.
This is what you asked for, and I brought it down.
Okay.
This is the letter to, I was going to say, you can take a look at it. It says right here, evaluation of the new interchange at the Boyce Road, Alpine Road, Bridge Road. And the other thing, I'll leave both these copies with you. This is a copy from the Southwest Regional Planning Commission, and it's designed to bypass Consumer Motors from I-79 from the Kermit's Interchange down Anderson Road. And I just want to stress to you again, if you allow those two bypasses to occur, we're going to end up like the Rogo Mall or something worse. Yeah, and I agree with your the precedent you set up on a piece of terrorism.
Added one more.
Yes, sir.
Just bring up something that Nino said. One of the last things they said was that if you have faith in your borough manager, police chief, your public works chief, whatever, don't micromanage them. Let them do their job.
I
agree.
Joe,
no,
I try to do that every day. I try to do that every day. I try to give them full rein, and you know, they have jobs. They're experts at them. I'm not in law enforcement, so when it comes to issues of the law, I rely on what the chief has to say. Same with engineering. Same with running the town. I try to listen to every piece of the information they have, and they're going to make intelligent, educated decisions.
Excuse me. With all due respect, I don't think my husband was directing that to you particularly.
No.
The thing with the meeting, with the time limit, if you don't have something written in stone, you could look like you're discriminating against someone else if you allow some people to talk for 15 minutes and cut somebody else off. I mean, just in this world, we're such a litigious society anymore that it's just to cover your own. You don't have to enforce it. As the chief will tell you, you don't have to enforce all the ordinances, but they're there if you need them.
And the chair does have the power, subject to the majority of the board, to exercise his own discretion and chairmanship over the decorum of the meeting. And certainly, the same argument about discrimination could be made if you had a 3-minute rule, and then you don't enforce it, is if you don't have a rule and you just use kind of, you know, on the fly reasonableness and, you know, taking the temperature of the room as your stand.
I always time people, but this thing doesn't work. So. Is there anything else?
That's enough.
Is there a motion to adjourn? Is there Bill Pelosi? Second by Joe Pelosi. All those in favor?
Aye.